I'm Brandy, this is Mark, and we attempt to co-host this meetup. Those are our Twitter handles, and you can tweet at us. Our agenda, so if you weren't here at 5:30, you missed it. We did a help me hour. There was help done, wasn't there?
Yes.
Okay. I got three problems solved.
Awesome. Wow. That's what we like to hear.
You owe now, buddy.
Now you got to come back and repay.
I'll drink some meat.
Wait a minute.
I know.
Yeah. That works.
No. recovering.
We have some swag up here. So these two cute little posters and there's some stickers up here are from WP Engine, who is graciously donating hosting for our ArizonaWP.org site. So you can come, and we've got a little, some other swag that we'll be giving away during the duration of our program here. Then we're gonna do announcements and introductions. We'll have an open forum. Then I'm going to thrill you with Google Analytics, because Google Analytics is interesting, right?
Yes.
Awesome. And then we'll have some Q&A because Google Analytics is a big monster and I will attempt to tackle the things that we can tackle, but there's probably gonna be questions that you come with. And then we'll have some networking, chit-chatting, wrap up. Elevate does close at 9. So we usually take the conversation around the corner to Buffalo Wild Wings and have some adult beverages and chit-chat after. So that's our plan for this evening. Our meetup sponsors. So we are very, very grateful to these companies because they donate money or locations or other things that help us put on our meetup. So Headway is our location sponsor here. They pay money so we can use this room, so we are very grateful to them. Skyhook, Media Temple, Rocket Bootcamp, Gangplank, and Axelsoft are other contributors that help us put on the WordPress meetups in the other part of the valley. Announcements! Do we have a volunteer note taker? Anyone who's willing to jot down? No. Dahlia is not volunteering.
She's analog, so.
Well, we are. Digital. Graciously, Bart is videotaping us, so we will have the full video. Well, we will try video instead of notes since we have no here. You can tweet with hashtag WPAZ if you want to tweet during our meetup. These slides and meeting notes will eventually be make their way to Arizona.wp.org. Mark and I are still working on getting our stuff put up there, so. If anyone was volunteering to help us, that would be great. Otherwise, we'll have to wait until we get around to it. Appointments. So this is the place where I'll talk about a couple things and then anybody else should chime in about other stuff they know that's going on in the Valley. So I'm speaking on Thursday at the Women in Business at 8:30 a.m. at the Microsoft Store in Scottsdale Fashion Square. I'll be talking about automation. There's a LinkedIn training from Dana Matthews. She was here a couple months ago. She's gonna be putting that on Thursday as well at Desk Hub. It is a $69 to attend, but well worth the investment if you are trying to up your game on LinkedIn.
And if you're a member of Networking
Phoenix,
which you can join for $10 for the first month, you get that free.
Yes, Barney makes an excellent point.
Good deal.
So, other events or things that you know are going on around the valley?
Only in my head.
Well, it is summer. It's not the hot time. Well, it is a hot time, but it's not the hot time for events around here. Anything else? Crickets? All right. I finally did it. Look, it's a slide with all the other meetups, so I don't have to do it. So there are 5 meetups that happen every month around the valley that have to do with or about WordPress. The Biz of Web happens in Tempe the first Tuesday of every month. And it's anybody that's in the business of doing stuff on the web. There are a lot of WordPress developers there, but also people who do deal with other platforms.
Is it technical as opposed to marketing?
No, it's much more about running the business. It covers marketing, but also like best practices in business and how to invoice.
It's used towards people who are
agencies
are serving other businesses rather than doing their own thing.
Yes. Right, okay. Yes. Second Thursday of every month is the Chandler meetup. That is the original meetup, and Carol Stambaugh has that one up. It tends to be very complete when they cover topics. They kind of go A to Z. They do have a lot of beginners down there, but they have all their stuff up on the website. So if you want to go check out what they talk about there, you can go to the website. Scottsdale happens the third Thursday of every month. And Betsy heads that up. I think Scott's helping her out now. And they try to do the balance between sort of power user and then dabble in developer once in a while. And then finally, the developer meetup. Oh, developer meetup's not on there. The developer meetup happens the fourth Thursday of every month. Finally got that right. Down in, I believe it's in Tempe.
Mesa.
Mesa, thank you.
At Stapley in the 60.
Skyhook.
Yes. Yeah. Did you go?
Yeah, it's in 2 days. They're talking about Git, the version control system. On this Thursday.
Everybody know what that is?
Yeah, I'm gonna start using it. And then there's this one that happens the fourth Tuesday of every month. So if you can't, there is no excuse for not getting your fill of WordPress in the Valley.
What do we do at this one?
We talk about marketing and WordPress. We try to cover the quick, fast, and easy ways.
So, do you read the meetup page? I was asked that question, what's the topic? And I knew that the leaning was we wanted WordPress stuff, but I tried to tell her, look, WordPress is just a tool for your overall marketing business strategy. It's one tool, it's not the only tool. And so we try to mix the WordPress and the marketing together. So that's the only way your business is going to survive, just like analytics. Without analytics, you don't even know if you're doing any good with your marketing efforts, you know.
You do a good job.
Well, we appreciate that, thank you. So yes, we do try to cover things that are WordPress centric and things that are marketing centric, because if you build a really awesome WordPress site and you don't tell anybody about it, then you're not really going to be achieving any of the goals. So, brings us to introductions, which I don't know why Font decided to use what it is, but here, we are going to go around the room. Everybody gets to talk, you don't just get to listen to me. We're going to have you tell us your name, your interest in WordPress, and your preferred ice cream flavor. If it is not one of the above, please feel free to fill in your other. I was giving people a place to start. Got to give them a blank canvas. Blank canvas is scary for people. So I think we're going to start with Brian, just because he's over here to my right. So, okay. Go.
Hi, I'm Brian Murphy. I work with digital marketing agencies in town as a WordPress developer. And favorite ice cream would be vanilla.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Kim Hanna, and I have one WordPress site, and I love moose tracks.
Ooh, I like it.
I'm pointing to you. You pointing to me?
We're going to go back.
You go first. Robert Holtz. I'm from out of town. I live in LA, but I come to Phoenix once a quarter, and I figured I'd find a WordPress meetup.
Wow.
Awesome. Well, welcome.
All you need
to go over here. There you go.
Yeah, I'm going to go back. We're going to go back around.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Mike. I have clients that use WordPress. I use WordPress myself, so I'm always trying to stay up to speed on what's going on. Favorite ice cream, Cold Stone, founder's favorite.
Oh, I love the specificity. Awesome. Our cameraman?
Second vote for founder's favorite.
Very good.
It's not fattening at all. I'm Bart, and I'm a writer and a communications consultant. Use WordPress for my business.
Awesome.
Not very effectively.
Well, we can fix that, right?
You're the only one in here.
Hi. My name is Dan Shaw. I'm new to this, so struggling along learning affiliate marketing. I'm from New England. We like coffee ice cream.
Very good. Okay, we're gonna skip to the back of the room.
My name is Mike. Starting my podcast, I'm trying to learn WordPress, and my favorite ice cream is vanilla.
Awesome.
My name is Madison. My interest in WordPress is I get to hang out with really cool people. My favorite is just, you know, I have so many favorites, but I'm just going to say vanilla.
It's too easy.
I'm Jerry Castor. Work primarily in home care in a marketing capacity. Here to learn about WordPress, try to read about it, and engage with people. Kind of a novice, but received some excellent help from Brian and Mark tonight on an issue, which was awesome. Favorite ice cream, but you know, fries has a vanilla and orange, which I like. It kind of mixes
a 50-50.
Yeah.
You just might want to go to both of
them. Oh, hi. Susan Lanfear, and I'm still a beginner. I'm beginning to get the difference between .org and .com, so.
We're making progress. Favorite ice cream?
Favorite ice cream.
Oh, chocolate chip mint.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Melanie. I'm a chiropractor and a writer, so I have a health and empowerment blog and WordPress based, of course, my first meetup. So I'm just trying to learn some other functions that I get stuck on. Okay. Iron out the wrinkles. And I don't eat ice cream, but if I had to pick probably chocolate mocha or something. Yeah.
I'm Andrea and I build and maintain WordPress sites. My favorite is Baskin Robbins chocolate peanut butter.
My name is Mindy. I've been using WordPress since it came out. I have several sites that I use to run. And my favorite ice cream is cookie dough.
Very good.
I'm Sherry Kessinger and I work with small businesses mostly on creating websites, creating WordPress websites, and then also in some cases updating if they already have a WordPress site. And then also usually morphs into a lot of the marketing, so social media and SEO and all that good stuff.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Ted Blank. I'm an amateur astronomer and I find myself owning and administering two astronomy WordPress websites. I'm hoping someday to become a beginner.
I love the aspiration. Okay, so we're going to come up here to Dahlia and work our way back around before I die.
Hi, I'm Dahlia and I'm developing two sites in WordPress. And my favorite ice cream is like you, coffee and chocolate together with a whole bunch of nuts and stuff.
Very good. Yeah, Ted didn't tell us his favorite ice cream.
I know. I'm trying to remember the name of it. Oh, it's Ben & Jerry, the one with chocolate and cherries in it.
Ah, Cherry Garcia. Yeah.
Cherry Garcia. There aren't any other
ones.
So that I don't forget, my favorite ice cream, I think, is Moose Tracks.
Mmm, three wheels for Moose Tracks. I like it.
And my name is Tina, and I guess I have a bunch of websites that I live with morning to night. But I focus primarily on writing content, and now I'm trying to shift more to promoting the content than just writing it.
Excellent.
And are you going to take notes tonight?
Well, we actually have video, so. We'll take that. All right.
I'm just going to let someone else do it because we're actually on our way back east, so we're.
This is their last stop on their way out of town.
Right.
Nice.
For the summer.
That's commitment.
For the summer. Where are you going?
All the way to New Hampshire.
The East Coast.
Eventually, yeah.
From Florida to Maine.
Wow.
Long drive.
I know. That's amazing.
We don't have time to stop anywhere. We're just going to go there. Take us till October to get back.
Yeah.
Just one big long road trip. Very nice.
My name's Lisa. I'm a freelance art director and designer. And I have a WordPress blog as well. And I'm trying to continue to grow my WordPress skills. I don't like ice cream at all, but if I said that I ate it, I would have to say it would have to be Häagen-Dazs, it would have to be mocha chocolate as well, or rum raisin, or butter pecan, or numerous other kinds that I just can't make myself eat anymore.
That's commitment, because you seem to have a lot of
very specific.
Okay.
My name's Dan, and I'm working on my second business in WordPress. If you guys want to go to it, path4change.com, PATH4change. Feedback appreciated. No, it's a counseling website. So if you know anybody who needs counseling, just stressed out, ITing too much, I have online services. Anyway, if you would leave an email or whatever, you look at it and you go, wow, why? Why'd you use that font or something? So I just like finally got it going this week, so I'm good for that.
Awesome.
I've been working on it for months.
That happens. Favorite ice cream?
I'm having a vanilla revival.
I've
never liked vanilla, but we have some strawberry pie that my wife made. Vanilla goes really good with that.
As a compliment, I like it. George?
I'm George Lerner. I keep WordPress sites running or get them running. And I have a couple of WordPress websites, including one about molten salt reactors to replace coal and oil. No dairy for me, but my favorite flavor is chocolate. Sprout has a 85% dark chocolate made from beans grown in Colombia that has a completely different chocolate flavor than most other varieties of chocolate.
Is that an ice cream?
That is chocolate. That is pieces of chocolate.
He doesn't do dairy.
That's his non-dairy alternative.
Yeah, it's good for your heart, too.
Absolutely.
You can do science.
Okay, Barney.
I'm Barney Davey. I train artists and photographers with online training. I'm an artist.
I should have made you go first.
Thank you. I was already, and then I just went completely fell apart. I'm an author and a blogger, and I have a couple of WordPress websites. I'm in a 12-step program for it. And I need to talk to you.
WordPressaholic.
I'm Brandy Lawson. My company is Tech Girl. I am a digital marketing expert and tech catalyst primarily for business coaches that have online programs. So WordPress is part of my repertoire. My favorite ice cream flavor is probably the Moose Trax Extreme, because you can never have enough chocolate.
Extreme.
I've not heard that one.
Yes, you gotta go extreme.
So I'm Mark Bretter. I have an e-commerce site, and I like doing it at WordPress. And not that I've ever had this ice cream, but Tillamook, Oregon Black Cherry, man, that stuff is amazing. It is the best ice cream I've never had. No, it's good. You should try it.
You should go get some right now.
Yeah. I've been brand advocating for them everywhere I go, every time the topic comes up.
Where do you get it?
Winco. You know what Winco is?
Yeah. I don't know where it is.
They're popping up.
You should go online and find one. It'd be worth the search.
What's
the name of this place? 59th and Bell. 59th
and Bell, correct. And what did you call it?
Tillamook Oregon Black Cherry. It's like $5 a carton. It's the best ice cream I've ever not had.
I did not know he was so passionate about it, but I'm glad that we had
it's a new thing for me. It's a new addiction.
Well, it's summer. We should talk about ice cream. All right. So now that we kind of know each other, it's open forum time. So if you've got questions, if you have happened upon a tool, plugin, website, blog, another resource that you think that someone else in this room might benefit from, a tip, trick, or something else you learned recently, please share. That's why we're here, to learn from one another.
Oh. So what did I screw up this time?
You installed the redirection plugin when the site already had pretty links on it.
Right.
And they both did the same thing, so they were fine.
But I took the redirection off.
And then things were fine. They were.
So I just didn't test well enough.
You just didn't wait a second longer to test. Plugin and the pretty links plugin do the same thing.
Because I got 404s.
When they're trying to do the same thing, then bad things happen.
And it's one thing if I screw up my own website, then when I screw up my accountability partner's website, I'm in trouble.
What does pretty links do?
So pretty links, it kind of does what it says. If you've got a place, so for instance, I have I do WordPress admin services. And I have a page called something like Tech Girl WordPress Admin Services, and the URL is like this long. So I made a pretty link that's techgirl.com/insure, WP Insure. So it's short. And what that does is it redirects to the longer link. So pretty links means that they're shorter or easier to remember or more friendly to share when you're talking. Also, in what Tina was trying to do is make a more SEO friendly link that would point to the original blog link. So that's both redirection and pretty links, that's their functionality.
Yeah, what happened was so my accountability partner, who doesn't even know what her keywords are, God help us. So I started showing her how to SEO one of my articles, and then I said, no, it'll make more sense if I do one of yours. And the article was about
business profitability, and the keyword that her team had put in was law. Had nothing to do with the article, nothing. So I basically went through and did everything except the URL. I left that to the end. And then I said, but I have to have the keyword in the URL, which meant I had to do a redirection. And it was just, and then I screwed it, and I thought, oh, I have to install the plugin because I installed the one I use. And,
and then she learned there are plugins that do, two plugins that do the same thing.
Right.
So how long did it take to solve it?
Well, I sent Brandy a emergency, please call. And then we went through it, and I tried to fix it, and I guess I did fix it, but I didn't wait long enough to test it. So probably on the phone 10 minutes, maybe.
Yeah.
And then I said, and I'm supposed to be packing because we're supposed to leave. So she said, great. Go pack, and I'll finish it. Because fortunately, she maintains that was safe too.
Yes.
Is there a way to edit multiple draft pages? I mean, can you get out and select the pages and do an edit? And it comes up in a real short box, but if you go to select one, you're back into the regular thing.
So there's a way, there's a quick edit that allows you to edit some attributes of a blog post, but not the content of it. So you can't edit multiple content blogs at once, but if you select multiples and then go to edit them, you can make them all published at once. You can change categories and tags, some limited.
But you can't change the URL, or you can't edit the URL like you can if you pull up a page.
Not multiples at once.
Because each one is different.
You wouldn't want to.
Each has its own URL, each blog.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, if you select it, it comes up in a, I thought it would come up and say, well, okay, you can edit this page. And then when you threw it in that page, it would go to the next, but no, it
it doesn't work like that.
Okay.
Yes, George.
There is, I found out about this from Woo Themes, has a bunch of themes that they've developed, and they mentioned specifically a page builder that works with any theme, where you can drag and drop and live edit, you can add widgets within there, insert a row and add widgets there, and it will take any existing content and bring that into their visual editor, which is something that a lot of other page editors don't mention, and I've found one where it actually just overwrites what you had there, so what you had there was gone.
That's not great.
Not great. So that is something to watch out for. So this is siteorigin.com/page-builder.
Interesting. So does everybody know what George is talking about when he talks about a page builder? Does anyone not know what we're talking about? Okay. So within a theme, there are frameworks, sort of, that will allow you to move around your pieces of content in a very visual way. So instead of like adding a div here or having to go through and inserting a sidebar with widgets and stuff, this gives you a almost like PowerPointy kind of layout where you can insert additional rows and put in other items, and it's much more user friendly for beginners to understand and create a page the way that you are thinking about it, rather than kind of how your theme has dictated to you or needing to know the HTML and CSS to create it yourself. And there's a lot of them out there, but George has been looking at them, it sounds like, and some of them will just trample all over your existing content.
Or the reverse. You say, oh, I don't want to use this anymore.
Oh, and then it goes.
And the content goes too.
Ooh.
And well, okay, that's not what I want. Let's go back. And it goes back and it didn't store. It's like, okay, that's the end of this one.
Can you store the content in different tables in the database? Is that what it does?
This one will actually, keep your data well. There are some others that don't. So anyway, this one was the one recommended by Woo Themes as one of the three that they recommended for use with their stuff. So, okay, good. That's a good recommendation.
So, siteorigin.com/page builder?
Siteorigin.com
/page-builder.
And that's the whole idea of a content management system, is you can change the look of it without losing your content.
Right. This would be great for your sales page or for your main page that needs to be different than your theme would be. Don't try to do this for, you know, every little, you know, I want to change the font on every page. No, that's, your theme should do that.
Yeah, the framework takes care of that. So the framework is your header, your navigation bar, your widgets, your footer, your widgets there. And this, what they're talking about is inside the content area, but it doesn't really look like a content box. It actually becomes a page with, you can add stuff to it, and rows and columns and all kinds of things. It's pretty cool.
Some themes do that, like Headway, right?
Yeah.
Headway does that, and some themes come with a built-in.
Right. I found one like that the other day. Visual Composer.
Yeah, is that WP Bakeries?
Yeah, WP
Bakeries,
right.
That one, you'll see that one in quite a few themes will include that as just built in so that it works well with what they've got going on. But if you have a theme that doesn't have a page builder in it and you were wanting to use one, that might be one to check out. But
it's a little expensive. $0.
We can afford that.
Woo.
Take it back.
That's pricey.
Well, we'll have to put that link up on the.
Yeah, we'll put that link
on the page. It's a little confusing at first because you get.
It's visual, so you look at it, you'll see it easier than we try to.
Well, no, what I'm saying is you don't realize whether you're supposed to be editing the in the editor or you're supposed to be editing the framework and the theme parameters and the fonts and stuff like that. You know, so once you figure it out, it's not too bad.
Keep going.
I've done it. And it's almost similar to Genesis in, to some respect, because Genesis uses a bunch of widgets.
Yeah, Genesis uses
sort
widget
of,
areas to
yeah,
kind right. of accomplish the same thing.
Right, yeah.
All of a sudden, there's a lot of them popping up. This is one that's well recommended and free.
Awesome.
Free's good.
Free's good.
I was going to say Tribe Theme, I think, has something like that.
Mm, yeah, a lot of the themes and theme houses are going more towards visual elements because not everybody wants to learn HTML and CSS.
The Thrive, I think, allows you to put it right into WordPress, and there's a little thing in WordPress. You know, when you go up into the dashboard and you're going into editing a page, on the far right hand side where it shows all the things that you can do, the highlight and all of that, there's the Thrive icon is there. You can click on that, and then up comes all the stuff that you can do things with. But that's $100 or something like that a year to recur.
So if I understood you correctly, you were saying that when you're using the PageMaker add-on, that you could use that within a blog page, or it would have to be a separate blog page?
No, within a blog page.
So you could add elements over on the widget side, or you could add it up on the top or the bottom. Or you could just
Inside the content area. Mm-hmm. So the theme framework determines the widgets, the header, the footer, the navigation. So this is inside your content area, but you can add elements into that, and you can usually drag and drop different elements. If you want to put an image, if you want to put text, if you want to put galleries, all kinds of stuff, you can actually add, and then you tell it, I want columns and rows, or you're going to add another row, you know, and it does all the, it's the same thing you're really doing when you're editing HTML and CSS, it's just drag and drop.
Right. It also works with custom post types.
Right, it uses custom post types, right.
Thank you, George. Other tips, tricks, things you learned, things you want to share?
Webpagetest.org.
Yes.
If you're interested to find out what the performance of your website is in terms of how fast it loads and what's causing it to not load fast, it will give you what's called a waterfall, which will show you by millisecond how fast your page loads. And since Google continues to put more emphasis on page speed loads, particularly because the world's going to mobile, and if your page doesn't load fast on mobile, you're going to lose a lot of traffic, that's a good place to get started. And there's a second one called GT Metrics with an X on the end that will also help you. If you
are these both .com?
webpagetest.org and GT Metrics with an X on the end.
Is that like .com?
Who uses page speed checkers? Okay, cool. I figured you would.
It's like Google Analytics. It's the I'm fun under the hood part that you wish. Well, I mean, you know, writing a blog post that's gonna, like a landing page is gonna get you a lot of money. That's cool. Digging in Google Analytics or web page speeds test, unless you're really geeky, not so much.
How do you spell page speed checkers?
I use GT Metrics primarily. I use Pingdom.
Yeah. That's Pingdom.
P-I-N-G-D-O-M.
With a P. Kingdom, but with a P.
Yep.
For something.
You just spell web page checkers. You
should. And so then when you're done, and then when you're done checking your page speed and you can see the things that are causing delays or whatever, then you obviously can go in and, I mean, if it's a plugin or if it's a, I mean, you should minify your CSS and your JavaScript. I mean,
CSS, right?
We had to go there. But
you use Cloudflare.
Yeah, use Cloudflare. There you go. Oh, what about Rocket? What's it called? It's a paid service.
The Rocket Loader?
It's
like
Rocket Loader, is that what it is?
Try Cloudflare?
No.
It's like W3 Cache.
But it's like W3 Cache. It's a plug-in. You pay for it, it's like $30 or whatever.
It's got a red rocket on it.
It has a little red rocket on it.
Yeah, I saw the plug-in.
It's supposed to have less configuration. Because, I mean, you could spend days and weeks on W3 Total Cache. I haven't anyways. Oh, my God. It's like never-ending. You know, and you try this and you try that and you test your speed, you know, and but anyways, that rocket,
I can't remember.
Rocket something or other.
Well, now you have to go figure out what it is.
And it's right. I want to try it because of just lower time to configure it.
Oh, yeah. Know?
Because each server is different. Mm-hmm. You know, for W3 Total Cache, it depends on what host you're on.
The WP Rocket, is that it?
I don't know.
Yeah,
it's got a little Mayana rocket, Stevens. And it's got boasts. Yeah, it has some high claims.
Mayanna Stevenson.
I think that's it. Speed up your WordPress site or something.
Okay,
like
so
that.
Does everybody know what caching is?
Yes.
Does anyone not know what caching is?
What do you WATM?
I don't like it. Well, actually, Cloudflare says that you can achieve higher results using both. And a lot of hosts will give you their preferred caching plugin with their preferred settings. What host did that happen on? I think it was Bluehost, as much as I hate to say it.
Bluehost uses Ajax caching.
It's wp-rocket.me.
Yeah. Excellent. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
So that is. WordPress is dynamic, meaning your content and the way it's displayed are stored separately. So when somebody comes to your site and requests it, WordPress goes, here's the content, here's how it's supposed to be displayed, voila, it's served up dynamically, which is awesome, but at the same time, it can take longer to generate pages. So caching is basically going through your site and taking a snapshot of what each one of those pages looks like and storing it.
So that when computers do that. When we look at the web.
Yes. So there's actually many levels of caching. There's website level caching, there's browser level caching.
Okay.
So, and then the Cloudflare comes in and is like middleman. So if you want to up the performance of your website, the first thing you will probably be looking at is caching at your website level and making sure that you're telling the browser.
Especially if you have pages and images that never change, it'll cache them and it'll just boom, boom, boom.
Yeah, for example, the header on your website,
menus.
As you go through different pages, if the header is the same, the browser shouldn't have to load that from the server each time. So configuring all these things, and then there's other settings that help minify, which is basically compress, do a bunch of different tactics to make each file that does need to be loaded many times or is always requested as small as possible.
Server side too, servers will store your pages, all your stuff in its memory or a memory pool rather than pulling from a hard drive every time. You have to pull from a hard drive, it's waiting for spindle count time, and it's slower, so it keeps it in memory. So
we could do a whole
servers thing. Right to your browser.
Yeah, so there's some technical aspects, there's some networking aspects, there's stuff that you can control, your website can control, there's stuff that your host control, there's stuff that the computer and the browser control. All those levels determine how quickly your web page can load. So caching is one way that you can try to make sure your house is in order to try to deliver your website as quickly as possible.
Speed is your friend.
And Cloudflare is probably the first step and the easiest step to do. If you're going to go down that road, or you should go down that road, but it's the easiest because it's just boom. You know, you got to change your DNS settings over to the Cloudflare servers, but then it just works.
So Cloudflare is a service that sits between the browser and your web host. So when somebody types in your domain, enter, your browser goes off and talks to the web host and says, hey, I need this, and then it serves it back. Well, Cloudflare sits in between and intercepts that. And by doing that, they can offer some performance enhancements, but also some security enhancements.
And it caches a version of your page. It's already gone to your server and run the HTML, the PHP, and all that stuff, and built the page, and then it puts it on Cloudflare to serve that up.
That's C-L-O-U-D-F-L-A-R-E.
Yep. And quite a few hosts have Cloudflare. If you go to your control panel, your cPanel, Cloudflare may be there, and that's an easy way to implement Cloudflare on your site because the host has already established a relationship with Cloudflare, and so as much, you don't have to change your DNS servers, you just turn on the service. So if you haven't used Cloudflare yet, I would check first on your control panel and see if it's there, because that's an easy way to get it turned on.
Very easy, yeah.
And the other quick way to speed things up is use JPEG images primarily and size them exactly what you need and make them only about 60% quality.
You have to look at it, but 60 is about the lowest end.
I could go,
but it depends. If it's just a text thing, you know, there's no... But anyway, if you can go down to 60, that's fine. But the lower the quality that you can get up there, the smaller the file and the faster the load. I have, as I'm uploading, I have one of the plugins.
Smush.
It's not Smush It, it's another one, but it does clean it up a little bit.
It's still better to do. Know what size you're going in and load it in that way.
I just load the biggest one I can find.
3,000 pixels.
Right out of my camera.
Performance. Blah, blah, blah. All right. Other things you want to share?
Yes.
I have two quick ones.
Yes.
Grammarly, I've been using lately, and it's my godsend. It checks your grammar a lot better than word processors do.
Yeah.
And Microthemer for CSS for when you want to tweak something on your page and you just don't know where it's at, install Microthemer and you highlight it and it tells you where that file is at. It'll actually create, you can manipulate it there and it'll create a CSS file and it'll tell you where the CSS file is. So then you don't want to save it separately.
So is it a plugin or an extension?
Microthemer.
T-H-E-M-E-R?
M-I-C-R-O. T-H-E-M-E-R, yeah.
Is that a plugin or
it's
extension?
A plugin.
Okay.
There's another one called CSS Hero, but it doesn't work with a lot of sites. So the Microthemer is the one that works.
Awesome.
If you're going to...
Grammarly.
Grammarly.
It's like grammar with a
grammar,
L-Y.
L-Y.
That's excellent. I've been using it for a number of years.
Yeah,
there's another one now that I just started using to go with it. Grammarly called
Hemingway
app.
Hemingway app.
I use Textbooker.
So I run it through Grammarly first, then I run it through the Hemingway app, and
even I know this is wrong.
And it causes I'm worried.
You told me about
Grammarly. This really tells you,
like
Hemingway, keep it short and sweet.
Oh, it's good.
It's improved my 100%
perfect.
It's improved my writing teaching method. Two of those together are awesome.
Those are great tools. Thank you. That was great. Yeah. Mike, did you have something?
I have a client that's talked to me today about what he's wanted to do, some surveys, online surveys, email surveys, web surveys.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any suggestions? I just saw a survey monkey.
What kind of surveys?
They want to send out to their clients, to their customers, and get feedback surveys through email or a web page, either one.
Well,
so they're trying to find the service. They're using MailChimp now already, but we're trying to find something that's more like MailChimp, but more on the survey side, so customers can get feedback and they can look at the analytics of it and see dynamics in that. Does anybody have a suggestion for
Survey? Survey Monkey, I love it. It works really well, and they've got some analytics that go with it. Though.
I like Typeform because it's slicker looking.
Typeform.
form.
Yep, type form. It's got analytics and stuff. It's got a free level and a paid level. It's
we're willing to buy it. I mean, it's not.
I think its user interface is much more engaging than kind of what SurveyMonkey has to offer. SurveyMonkey is very much focused on true polls and stuff like that. Typeform is more like, yeah, surveys, but fancier.
Has some style to it.
It looks really nice, and you get presented with each question individually, and you can personalize it a little, like jazz it up, and it's not so ugly.
You know, ability, if it's a long questionnaire, people can finish it like at 50%, save it, come back to it, and remember.
I don't know if it has to save it to come back, but I would be really curious. So from a marketing perspective,
right,
there better be a very, very big pot of gold at the end of that rainbow.
Exactly. I do too, that, but they asked me that too. It's like, well, if they're into it and they decide a couple questions they don't want to do right now, so they come back to it.
Yeah, that's not going to happen.
There's no 30-foot motorhome.
So I would maybe instead figure out what they want to know most.
Put that at the top.
And yeah, like see if it can be like one or two questions, what do they want to know most, see who answers that, and then go after those people with more questions and a bigger pot of gold.
Like adaptive.
You can go to quick surveys too, and they'll actually run it. They'll take a random sampling of their database and do a survey for you, even if you don't have.
I saw that too.
I've used them.
They got people that you can do their field marketing and
for. But their forms are not too bad. I grew up.
Do you use graphic forms?
Graphic
forms?
Oh, gravity form?
On the website?
If they ever use that, then there's a survey add-on.
Or you can also just go to Google and do Google Forms. It's pretty easy. Yep.
Great. Okay. So I think that wraps us up. Any other, like, we can't move on until you have an answer or whether you share this?
I need to know about Google Analytics. It's the only reason I came here.
What a fortunate coincidence, because that, you want to talk about that. Thank you for the segue.
Totally, but you know what's a funny question? Is there any performance information in analytics, given the discussion we just had?
There is. Okay. I've looked at it. I think it requires connection with Webmaster tool or something. It uses other parts of Google, but there is some information there. We aren't going to talk about that tonight. Instead, we are going to talk about analytics spam. My favorite, not favorite. It's totally not my favorite thing. But I will show you how to fix it.
Yay.
Segments versus filters, because you want to know these things. Just nod. Yeah. We'll talk about saving views. I'm not sure what I was trying to check there, but it's supposed to be views. We'll work on setting up custom dashboards and reports, and then we will finalize with creating a monthly email report that will land in your email box on the first of every month and give you your analytics. You ready to get started? Because we're done with the slideshow now. And I'm
sounds like brain dump.
We're doing it anyway.
Brain dump? No.
Are you going to tell us why we need this information?
Because I said so, Barney. That's the most important reason. No. All right. You need this information because analytics allows you to make good decisions about what you're doing with your website and also see what's going on when people are on your website. Because as marketers, we like to think we have good intuition. Like, we know what our audience wants, and we can read their minds, and 90% of the time we're just wrong, which is why testing is important and measuring is important. So, does everybody have Google Analytics? Yay! Okay. Who looks at their analytics reports with any sort of regularity? Okay. Yeah, well, all right, good. So, do you know how to get to your analytics reports? Analytics.google.com or google.com/analytics. And when you get there, you're going to log in with your Google account that has access to your analytics. So, with a small segue here. You probably have more than one Google account. Even if you don't think you do, you totally do. Know which Google account your analytics are associated with. And if you have someone else create a website for you, or you need someone else to look at your analytics, you can add users. within analytics, but make sure that they know which Google account they're using so that you share it to the right email address when you do add users. Okay, so anybody with a computer, are you on your analytics? You're in Google Analytics? You ready to rock and roll? Okay, so when you log in, typically you will see your overview, totally not in the right place. Your overview. So, while this is all very interesting information, at the end of the day, what is important to you and what you should be looking at, I can't tell you. Because it depends on your business and it depends on what you're trying to get your users to do on your site. So we will walk through several things and create a custom dashboard, but what you really have to decide, what you really have to know about your website is why. Why do you want people to come there? What are you trying to get them to do? And when you know those two things, then you can start to understand what's going to be important in analytics. I can't tell you that because I don't know what your website's trying to accomplish. For example, Mark has an e-commerce site. He's trying to get people to buy stuff. That's why he wants them to come to their site. That's what he wants to accomplish by there. So his goal is to get them to the checkout page, past the checkout page, to the thank you and fair payment page. That's his goal. So to get them to there, they come to a product page and there's other things. So he's going to be watching how people go through his site. He's going to be finding out where people are dropping off their site, where people are going away from the path that he wants them to take. And then he will either take measures on his website or do some other tracking, but that's what his site's about. Well, that's not what my site's about. I'm not selling stuff on my site. So I'll have different goals and different things that I'm looking at when it comes to my site. So you have to know what you're trying to do in order for any of this to make any difference to you. Got that much? Okay. All right, so the first thing that you may be experiencing is analytics spam. Spam, 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 it's come to analytics.
So,
what I did, I just changed my segment. We'll talk about segments in a minute. I just changed my segment to show you, this is what my regular information looks like in my Google Analytics. So if you all, you do this with me, go down to acquisition, all traffic, and click on channels.
You said?
Channels, yep. Now here, I want you to go to referral, and referral might be a different number for you, but find referral and click on referral. Everybody there?
Oh wow, I have some spam.
If you see anything that looks like this, how to stop referralspam.eu, $100-seo.com.
That's a free social button.
I don't know
how
yes, that is spam.
There are free social buttons. I got that one.
Yeah, so.
Maybe you should say don't click on those. Yeah.
Okay, don't click on those. They are spam sites. I posted a link to this article by Ben, who is kind enough to share with us a whole lot of information, but I'm going to scroll down to the list of offending sites. So if you see any of these sites,
Huffington Post.
So, but it's spelled wrong.
Huffington.
Huffington Post.
If you see any of these sites,
very true.
These are spam.
It's V-I-G-E-T.
V-I-G-E-T. Yeah, I put the link in the comments for the meetup. Unfortunately, this list of sites keeps growing and growing.
So, are you going to explain how these get to referral to your sites?
Well, they actually, some of them actually visit your site, and some of them are just inserting their supposed visit into your spam, into your analytics.
How do they find your site?
Crawlers.
Yeah.
And Google, and the Google codes and how Google processes things is common. Enough people use Google Analytics that it was worth their time to reverse engineer it.
Google still doesn't know exactly why they're doing this.
So Ben gives us a little insight here. Hang on.
Yeah.
So I'm sure people that have analytics sites are probably more valuable to hack than just, you know, mom and pops that don't have analytics, because we might have access to hundreds of websites potentially, you know, so if they can hack us, then...
Well, but they're not hacking, they're not, this isn't actually anything to do with your site.
No, it has to do with your computer, right?
No.
No.
Your website.
It has nothing to...
Just your analytics.
Sorry. Just your analytics.
Just,
I know, but they want you to click on it so they can get it.
Oh, so they want you to click on it, or there's other reasons that they want to show up in basically millions of people's stats. Because if you're sharing any of your analytics information, or if you're using that in other places, then their website gets more visibility.
Right.
So it's ucky. Yes, it's working, and it's ucky. So back here, and this. Obviously, my site doesn't have huge numbers, so these numbers are messing up my stats. I don't really know how many people are visiting. I can't really see what's affecting my traffic because I've got this crap in here. So let's fix it.
So I'm sorry, how did you get from channels to get this?
I clicked on referral. So here on channels, I just clicked on referral. And the other thing that I'm not seeing is that this is just showing me my top 10. So there's probably more that are just got one or two visits that are 11 plus. Okay, so we're going to fix this.
Well, you should go to howtostopreferralspam.eu, right?
No, you should not. The last thing you should do is do that. So there's a couple ways to slice and dice this for the sake of time. I'm just going to walk you through creating a segment in your Google Analytics that will basically just filter out all the known bad sites. You may have to come back into your referrals list and see if we got them all, but it will get most of them. Yes, Mike?
Just along with that, I use Cloudflare, so there's an interface in Cloudflare. You say, I don't want this particular website visiting my website. You can block it. It blocks it at a DNS level. And it never ever show up in your Google Analytics site.
That's on Cloudflare?
Yeah.
Which works if they actually came to your site.
Right.
There's a lot of these that aren't actually coming to your
but
site.
But it will filter something.
It will filter something, yes. So there's a couple other approaches. Like, you can go create a full-on filter. Okay, so filters versus segments. When Google is collecting data about your website, at midnight every night, it takes that data and it processes it and it dumps it into analytics so that you can look at it the next day. You can set up filters so that when it goes through and processes it, it at that point will discard information and never have it when it dumps it into your Google Analytics. And that's great for everything from today forward, but it doesn't work in reverse because Google only processes your analytics once. So if you set up a filter, which we're not going to go through, but I wanted to explain filters versus segments. If you set up a filter, you can have up to 25 different views of your analytics and have different filters for each. You should always keep an all sessions so that you've got a baseline of data, everything, but then you can create an additional one that maybe filters out all the spam stuff. And that would work from today going forward, but it won't work for anything in the past.
Oh, so the extra views won't go back?
No, because Google only processes your data once.
And so it'll process up to 25 views and it'll archive those daily forever?
Yes.
Interesting.
But it only happens from the day you create the view going forward. Segments basically takes your existing data and gives you filtered views of your existing data. So it is using the data after Google has processed it and giving you different views. And so up here at the top of each one of these different items, it tells you what segment you're looking at. So I'm guessing all of you have all sessions listed there. Anybody have something different? No? Okay. All right. So over here, you can click Add Segment. Now here, you can begin to whittle down what you're looking at from a data point of view and look at it in different ways. So this over here is the different ways that you can look at the data. The segments is basically reducing how much data that you're looking at. Does that make sense? Okay. So what we want to do is we want to create a segment.
I'm sorry.
Yes?
How did you get to?
I clicked on.
Add segment.
Hang on, I gotta cancel out here. Up here, where it says all sections, next to it says add segment.
Gotcha. Okay.
Now there are some, you will not have this all traffic without spam in there, but you will have the rest of these bounce sessions, et cetera, et cetera. What I'm gonna walk you through is how to add this all traffic without spam. But first, I have to go share. Google Analytics has this Analytics Solutions Gallery, where other people who have figured out stuff can share their views and other things that they've done. So I'm going to go
share, so we can import it.
This, except for it's a weird. I shared it earlier and then I figured out I didn't have it quite correct, so then I had to go back and fix it and now I have to reshare it. Okay. Every single piece on your individual site, but it will probably get most of it.
But how do we do that where?
Oh. Oh.
Hang on. When you're in Add Segment, you're going to go Import from Gallery.
Okay.
And then when you get there, because I created this, you're going to search for the Tech Girl, and it's going to load up this. And then you're going to click Import.
And why don't you spell that out for people?
T-E-K-G-R-L.
G-R-L. No I.
No, I wanted the shortest domain possible, so vowels became optional.
Is it your license plate?
And then it says any view or my name.
Okay, so when you click on import. Yes, okay, so you should. The analytics that you are currently in, the site and the view that you're currently in will show up here by default, so leave that. If you want to call it something else, this was my name for it. If you want to call it something else, you can rename it here. But if you're all good with that, then just click create. Everybody good so far?
Then you get a brief page.
Does it get applied to all website data or?
No. This is a segment available to you for the website that you're in.
Not we only have one, it will be all website.
Yes.
So this includes your list of spam that you've pre-created for this use?
This includes, what's his name? Ben's list, plus my list.
Awesome.
So it may not be comprehensive, but
it's and it may not. They may not all be on our
right.
But then
if they came
in, it's
kind of
awesome.
Okay, so now, where are you guys?
What's it called? Importing? What are we importing?
Segment.
Segment.
So mine's in the list.
And we have to look for search. You.
Yeah, you just have to search for the space TEKGRL because that's my user in the solutions gallery. All right, so now if you are back to overview.
I'm not, I ended up with this weird screen.
Oh, okay, so hit save. If you're on the weird screen.
That sounds safe. What could go wrong?
If there's a blue save button at the top, click it. Okay. Are we good? Are we back?
Okay. Yeah, we have a hyperlink. This is all great, but that's fine.
That's fine. Okay. So now, hopefully, you're looking at this again. And now there's available to you an option that says all traffic without spam. Now, you can check both of these. And they'll be both available. I like to only look at one segment at a time when it comes to spam or not spam. So I unchecked all sessions and I checked all traffic without spam. And then I came down here and I'll hit apply.
Where's the one of those boxes to check?
You gotta hit save. You missed the, if there's a blue save button, click it.
So I click on all traffic without spam and I end up with that weird page again.
Oh, no. Hit save.
Blue save button.
Yep. Oh, okay. Go back. If you look at the top of your screen, okay, I'll use a mouse instead of point. If you look at the top of your screen and you're looking at admin, right. Go over and click on reporting.
I asked.
All right. So now, if you're on reporting, hopefully.
Wait a minute. Now you have to just slow down a minute. So switch.
Oh,
alter tab. From what did it say?
Admin to reporting.
Back.
All right, is everybody on reporting?
Reporting.
Okay, so let's go back to audience overview if you aren't already there.
Okay.
Everybody good?
Good.
All right, so now we can click over here on add segment. And hopefully you see this. And here's where you will uncheck all sessions and check all traffic without spam.
Right.
Everybody good? No warning?
No. I'm sorry, the ad segments.
Yep, there, and then you uncheck all sessions and check all traffic.
And segment.
And then you have to scroll to the bottom.
And uncheck.
And say, and apply.
Uncheck.
Yeah, okay. And check without.
Everybody good?
No, I can't write it.
You're typing the instructions.
I'm trying.
The group, it's all good.
So I'm trying to get back to that screen. I'm at
it. All right, where are you? Where are you up here? What do you want?
Because I'm reporting.
You're on reporting?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm on reporting audience overview.
200.
Okay.
Go to add segment again.
Yeah, so go to add segment. You see it for him, George?
Do you know the current? You're not supposed to
know. Yes.
I see it, George.
Yeah. Oh, all right. Good.
Okay.
All right. So then you've got the check boxes. Check the correct boxes. Then hit apply, which is the blue button at the bottom. Everybody else good?
And check all sessions. Sorry. Okay, we should
have done
that. Thanks. I don't want to do it all that.
Okay, so now we're going to go verify that this actually works.
No, you go all the way down there. Not here, over there. To your out of bar, to
apply. So we're going back to acquisition.
Huge screen.
All traffic. Channels.
Okay.
Acquisition, all traffic, channels. And then we're going to click on referral again.
That's cool. I got 100 websites, SEO.
7,000.
And so now, this looks better because I actually had to go check. Medium.com is a legit site. I don't know about flowdoc.com.
Tech Girl.
I got UK. Yeah, wow.
Tech Girl's pretty shaky.
Yeah, I know.
38%
bounce rate. KR? What's that?
I would have to go check that one.
All right.
And how I check it is I will go to Google and I say, what is, and then I put the domain name. I do not go to the domain name.
She went back to...
I go to Google and say, what is, and I enter the domain name. Yeah, so a couple of these I might go check, like flow.com. But Medium, Google.fr, ArizonaWP.org, those are all legit sites. So, so I have that problem with some of them. All of them?
And then I think we
have. What is this?
I actually had that problem as I was trying to create this with some of the other stuff that was out there. I kept getting rid of legitimate traffic. So that's how we verified that we are removing our analytics spam work, or didn't work. If you still have questionable sites here, you may need to expand that filter, that segment. I'm sorry.
Add another condition.
You may want to come back for Help Me Hour if you want to do that. Yeah, Mark?
So you have Tech Girl in there. I also have traffic from my stat counter where I'm actually clicking on the link for some reason. So how do I get rid of that one source? Would I have to go back in and create another segment?
You would go, if you wanted that out of your spam segment, you would go in to the segment and edit the conditions of the segment.
Okay, so I can just take it out of that.
You cut and paste it, put it in Notepad, you'll see how they built it, and you can just take out the other one and put the other one in there and add another condition for it.
But you could just use that condition, those condition fields, right?
Yes, you can just use the condition
fields. It'll build the condition for you, right?
No, it won't build it for you. You have to put in the string.
It's a regex string.
I'm saying, but if you just click on contains,
yes, but you have to put in the regular expression.
Oh, okay.
And so if you're not familiar with regular expressions, you might want to come to Help Me Out. It's an hour before this meeting starts. Yeah, there's some things that you will probably never have to know when it comes to adding more, which is why I figured it was just easier to build this and have you import it. So I will attempt to keep that updated for you.
So as you update it, it will automatically update? Or no? What have to do with import?
I don't know how the solutions gallery works if it's a one-time import. You may have to re-import. So
you have to send out an email.
Put this on your mailer.
Yeah. Right. Sign up for my email. Alright. So that's spam stuff. So hopefully it got rid of most of what you were seeing in there that was bad. But it gives us a better, I'm going back to audience overview here. It gives us some better information to work from when it comes to what we've got going on. All right, let me go back to my list here. Segment, we talked about that. All right, so as you're poking around, looking at things, if you find something interesting, let's say I like looking at my social. So what went to channels, and then I clicked on social to go see how much traffic I'm getting from what Google considers to be social networks. And I like this. I want to come back and look at it again, and I don't want to have to click to get there. Or I'm doing some fancy stuff with dimensions, which we're not going to get into, but I'm looking at time or something, like trying to see what time the visitors are coming to my site. But once I get a view, once I get a view that I like and I want to save it, go up to shortcut. It makes no sense. I'm not here to try to explain the Google UI. I'm only here to tell you how to use it. If you click shortcut, it will basically say, hey, you want to save this current configuration? What would you like it to be called? So I'm going to call this Social Channels Insights. And then click OK. What you don't see is that up here, under shortcuts, I now have a new item called Social Channel Insights. So if you get to a view, maybe you're dinking around and you've looked at several different dimensions of your data and you found something you'd like, create a shortcut. Even if you think, I don't know if I want to look at this again, if I was dinking around long enough, I'm like, this is an interesting view of my data. I will create a shortcut so that I can come back to that later. And maybe I'll modify it again and create another shortcut. But this is how you save views. For me, this is save view in Google Analytics. So that's how you save your views. Yes?
Is there a web password for the Wi-Fi here?
Yes, it is dirty chai one. And I'm not really comfortable saying that, but dirty chai, C-H-A-I, and then the number one.
When you connect to the free Wi-Fi with deals, I did it.
The Elevate Guest.
Elevate, they've got a new one. They don't have the deal one anymore. It's Elevate Guest.
It's still available.
I connected the free Elevate Rise Wi-Fi to deals.
Or you can use that password. Okay. So, questions on saving views.
We can hack Jordan's.
What was that called again that you put to save?
Shortcut.
I'm on her side.
Alright. Everybody know how to use that now?
Sweet.
Alright.
Nice.
Okay, now for the coup de grace. Dashboards. We're going to create a custom dashboard.
Ooh. Ah.
Didn't find that really convincing, but okay. So up at the top, you've got, so dashboards are what they sound like. This is you pulling together pieces of information that are important to you. For example, I've got an audience demographic dashboard that shows me the demographic information that Google has pulled together. I've got my dashboard, which shows me visits, visitors, where they're from, by browser, duration, bounce rate, and goal completions.
That's good for a ooh and That's pretty cool.
So basically, you can take the bits and pieces that are of interest to you and put them in all in one place. That's what the dashboard is.
Did you share these?
I did share this.
And is it done the same way as the other?
Yes. So we're going to go through and create two dashboards. We'll do import one, and then we'll do one from scratch.
Beautiful. All
right. So under dashboards, how you create a new dashboard is, fortunately, intuitively, you click new dashboard. Now here,
so
you
under dash.
Click new dashboard.
Yep. I'm trying to figure out.
Are you in reporting?
I'm under reporting and there's dashboard.
Scroll to the very, very top.
I am.
Okay. And then expand dashboard. Okay. New dashboard. So you get this cute little box that says, what do you want to do? So if you want to import from gallery, you click the import from gallery button.
Are we doing that one first?
Yes. It's easy, so we'll go do it. Here, you're going to search for the tech girl, T-E-K-G-R-L, because I shared it with you.
Why do we have to put the? Why can't we put tech girl since
you
the only
you
tech girl?
You totally probably could.
No, you don't have to put the.
But she's
the
tech
only
girl.
Girl.
Okay, so to Dahlia's point, you do not need the. And here I have shared my basic starter dashboard. So you would click import. Again, it will say, okay, which site do you want it associated with? It will default to the one that you're in. It will give you the opportunity to call it something besides my dashboard. This super cool, awesome dashboard.
By the tech
girl. Then click create.
Will these be available when we get home too, or is it just in this room?
No, it will be available when you come.
In the
gallery. This is shared on the Analytics Solutions Gallery.
Okay.
Can you give a 1 minute statement about that gallery?
Fortunately, allowed everybody who has analytics that have created segments, filters, dashboards, there may be some other stuff in there that they like to share it with the world.
Okay.
So, the solutions,
Alaska.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, because it's part of the U.S.
No, really?
I could swear twice.
The analytics solutions gallery looks like this. You can go to google.com/analytics/gallery and look at, look, my solutions. All solutions. Oh, I've got search terms in here. So you can look at, you can sort by, you can filter by, you can filter by ranking, you can sort by category, you can do all kinds of filtering to see, to find things that may be of interest to you, if you have time to kill.
you have no life.
Otherwise, hopefully, when you imported the super cool awesome dashboard or whatever you decided to call it, you got what I created for you. So you are seeing new visits, unique visitors, where your visitors are from, peak browser, bounce rate, average visit duration of pages per visit, and then goal completions. Now, goals I'm not going to get to today, but goals is one of the very powerful things about analytics, is that you can tell Google what you want people to have do on your site. So in Mark's case, his thank you page after they're done checking out and buying their stuff, that's his goal. So basically, he's going to tell Google, this page, when people hit here, that's where I want them to be. So then he'll be able to track that easily here, because Google is going, hey, they hit this page, that means that they accomplished your goal. Now, for some of us, maybe it's the thank you page after they opt into our list, or maybe there's several goals that we have, like the first thing we want them to do is visit this particular blog article or this landing page, and then we want them to go to the thank you page, and then we've re-engaged them and we want them to go buy our cheap ebook. So you can set, I think, up to 5 goals in Google and be tracking people's progress, essentially, through what you want them to be doing on your site.
That's funneling.
It is funneling. All right, so everybody has this dashboard? Yes.
Can you, on the dashboard, does that eliminate the referrer spam?
No, so dashboard is a view of our existing data set, and we apply the segment to our data set. So
no.
So the segment, you would have to go back to audience overview.
So if you change that segment, it'll apply to that dashboard, yeah. Correct?
Yes. Oh, no, there it is. It's at the top of the dashboard.
So can we see your site and where it went up high and do a split screen and like where's your most active page? And
well, we can see, that's not in this, but we can see that my...
You'll have to add that segment.
Yeah, just right there, that segment.
Yeah.
Okay, so to finish answering the question over here, in the dashboard, uh-huh. Up at the top, just like where we were before, you will add segment, you will uncheck all sessions, you check all traffic without spam, you hit apply. And now, when you look at the top of your view, it will always tell you what you're looking at. So that's how you verify. Great question.
And Russia's not dark blue anymore.
And Russia's not dark blue anymore. Yes!
You have 10 minutes left on the video.
Okay, thank you.
Thing. Just so you say the most important stuff first.
I appreciate that part. Okay. All right, so then that's our dashboard. Dahlia, we'll come back to that, your question, when we're done with creating a dashboard, since we've got 10 minutes of video left. All right, so now you've imported a dashboard. And you can see here, I've got private dashboards, and I have shared dashboards. Now, if you are the only one who's ever looking at your analytics, you don't care. It doesn't matter to you. If you are not the only one ever looking at your analytics, and other people have access to the analytics, and you would like them to also see the views that you see, you need to share. Sharing is caring. You need to share object. Again, I'm not trying to explain their UI, I'm just telling you how to use it. So you want to share the object. By doing that, did you see that it just showed up in my shared dashboards? That means that other viewers of this analytics set can now see that dashboard.
How'd you get to share?
You get clicked on the share link.
Up here, right here, it says share. Dan, right here. Share, and then, I already shared it.
It says share it after.
Here we go. At the top of the dashboard, hit share, and then hit share object.
And we're all sharing the thing.
Oh, good. Thank you.
All right. So everybody understand the difference between private and shared?
There will be a test after this.
No test.
You can't leave without a 90.
And you only care.
Okay, so we want to see where your mountains are.
So you're going to feed us? Well, we're going to create a dashboard first. Okay, so now, we're going to create a new dashboard with a blank canvas. We're going to call this from scratch, or whatever you want to call it. Create dashboard. And it gives you a, well, it gives you the ability to add widgets. So when you have blank canvas, you're going to add widgets.
To create dashboard.
So you can choose real time. You're probably not going to use. We'll just discount that right now. You're probably not going to use real time unless you have a crazy, crazy, busy, highly visited site. Anybody qualify?
Probably too
busy. That's why we're all here.
Nicely done, Bernie. Alright. So you're going to care about the standard widgets. And a metric is basically a table of information. Timeline is a graph. Geomap, self-explanatory. Table, pie, bar. So we're going to actually go table here.
Table, table.
You can call the widget whatever you'd like.
Okay. Well, tell us where we're going. What kind of data are we?
I haven't decided yet. We're going to look at trenches.
I can't name it until I know what it is.
Well, then come back to that.
Randy undecided.
Randy undecided. Very good. So, as you can see, this is not the easiest way to go about creating a dashboard. So if you really know exactly what you want, or you've mapped out, these are my website goals, this is what I want people to be doing, and then you've translated that into exactly what you want to look at, then you would create one from scratch. Otherwise, this is not the fastest path to...
We could always start with one and then modify it.
That would be how I do it. but I wanted to show you that you did have options. So, in the account,
Oh, and you can decide how big it is.
For set of new sessions.
Wow.
Percent exit.
You can get super nerdy with this.
You can get, so Google Analytics is extremely powerful, which means it's extremely complex, which is why most of us are like, la 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 la.
So the same guys at Amazon are looking at this as well as the person with the 5 visitors to their workplace.
Yes. So you can determine how many rows that you want in the table. You can add a filter. You can link to a reporter URL. So if you're doing like a super custom thing for CEO, a C-level team, or a client who's doing e-commerce, like if you've got e-commerce and you know exactly what you're trying to achieve, you probably will start from this perspective. But you can do lots of stuff. And when you hit save, it adds in that information that you just asked for. And then you can add another widget and add more views and other things that you want to look at.
Can you do a pie chart showing the social breakdown?
I will attempt to.
Can you have it automatically save your stats every week?
What do you mean by automatically save your stats?
Just automatically save your stats every week.
Oh, all the information is there.
It's always saved. You can have an email.
It's all there. She's just manipulating the view of it. Filtering
it. No, but I'm saying almost
like a pie chart.
Yeah, like every week you have like instead of going back in data.
I'm guessing you can go in and create a report.
Select the dimension. You can do a weekly type dimension.
Is it the dimension?
So you can have it email you a PDF of whatever you want.
Yes. Yeah.
There you go.
It might seem like silly, but the titles in this menu don't match the titles that you kind of crawl down.
No, they don't. Again, it's not very explained
to Google UI. Blanket statement.
Well, we'll just try it. Okay, my dimension is users.
You know when you crawl down on the left? Column,
no.
And there are words that you learn. That's not what's used in this menu. So like you're.
So it's not user friendly UI UX.
It's Google.
Are you kidding me? You didn't figure
it's
that out.
It's not. It's not.
Again, not here to explain the UI. I'm just showing you how to use it to the best of my
ability. Simple answer is no.
So if you don't think Google has programming standards, do you?
That's why people are so frustrated with it, because it's so, it is so powerful, but they don't make it easy, you know, like anything else. Like,
it's easy.
No, Tina, I cannot accomplish that at this juncture.
Yeah, I'm trying to, too.
Okay.
At least I don't want. So, start with a dashboard.
If you import a dashboard, how would you then reverse engineer to figure out the widget that you want? So you could go look for a dashboard.
So here, we're in this super awesome cool dashboard. And you see over on unique visitors, I have a massive click the pencil.
Okay.
I clicked the pencil.
Okay.
And then you can see what they did.
So that's how you reverse engineer the widgets you want.
Mm-hmm.
And once you have a widget stored, can you use it in multiple dashboards?
You can.
So you just have to go find a dashboard that the social widgets you want, and then
somebody already did this. If you can figure it out.
And if Google cared about the user experience, you'd actually be able to drag and drop. But I'm already proving that they don't care.
But no, they care about the data, because that's where the money's at.
That's where the
okay. So okay, finally.
So everybody
email ready
to you. Is from Chrome. Everybody that likes your site is on Chrome.
Because they're smart people. So, what I want, this is the punchline here.
Funny
Gene. So once you've got...
Funny?
Once you've got your custom dashboard, then if you want this to arrive in your email box, you will click email. And then you will say who it's to, and you will put a subject in here. Maybe this is the monthly. The super cool awesome dashboard, you will select the frequency that you want, monthly, get once, daily, you can choose the day of the week, or if you choose monthly, you can choose the day of the month, you can make it active for 12 months, you cannot go longer than 12 months, you actually have to come back in here and reset it after a year, I'm so sorry. And then you can give yourself a little note, like, look at this stuff, it is important.
Can you do more than one email?
Yes, you can. You can do more than one email. You can also have multiple dashboards that get emailed to you at different times. So you can set this up so that you don't actually have to come in here, that just stuff that arrives in your inbox.
Does it make a report, or does it just...
It makes a PDF report and attaches it.
You can totally geek out on this one.
Well, except there are a lot of vendors that are doing it locked in.
So, well...
Nice.
It's free versus pay.
It's the same thing with there's a lot of people who are building nice websites, WordPress websites for it too.
But
okay, we've got 1 minute. So any questions on dashboards, custom reports, or emailing stuff to yourself so you don't have to log into analytics?
Fantastic. Great job.
All right, you guys learned something.
Understandable. And being patient with everybody in here is a knucklehead with a question, like, including me. Where is that?
No.
All without breaking a sweat. Very impressive.
Okay.
She's done a great job, but she's only touched on about 5%.
Not even. Yeah, I'd say I've probably scratched maybe 1%. Maybe.
You could spend a whole week just screwing around here.
A week.
Google has created gigantic training programs. This is a very, very powerful tool designed for Google, by Google, so that they can grow their ad revenue. That's the reason Google Analytics exists, and they're nice enough to share it with us, so we will just deal with their idiosyncrasies and interesting UI. I think there are people at Google that do.